so I'm hoping this video will be up by Saturday morning. However, we will post the actual PowerPoint presentation tomorrow. We all agree that there are long-standing traffic problems at 352 and King Road.
No, we don't.
Accidents, near misses, delays, and cut-throughs have troubled the area for many years. The earliest proposal I'm aware of was back in 2005 or so, but there may have been something even before that. About 2 years ago, we asked our traffic engineer, McMahon Associates, who works for both East Whiteland and East Goshen, to dust off the old plans and update them to see what might be done. East Whiteland contacted East Goshen, and we agreed to work together on a plan. However, if any of you came here believing a solution has already been chosen, you will be disappointed. Let me explain why. Each of the eight supervisors has varying levels of knowledge about the different proposals. Most of the discussion to date has taken place at the staff level in monthly transportation meetings, which is, in fact, the normal process. So you see, the presentation we will all hear tonight is new. The supervisors received the draft on Monday afternoon, but this will be the first time we have seen and heard it explained in full. As you may know, sunshine laws prevent a quorum of supervisors from deliberating in non-public meetings. This is particularly challenging with a three-person board like East Whiteland, because two people constitute a quorum. With a five-member board like East Goshen's, three people make a quorum. So neither board has made a decision on this behind closed doors. All of us, supervisors and residents, are here to listen and ask questions. Our intention is to fix this intersection in a way that causes minimal disruption, costs very little, and makes everyone happy. That may be challenging. But our job as supervisors is to try to improve a dangerous and frustrating situation. I am confident that I speak for all of us here when I say we will give it our very best effort. Before we continue, let me lay out the process for tonight and for going forward. There are several steps we will be taking. First, I will ask the boards if they want to say a few words about the challenge we face before we get into the heart of the meeting. Second, Chris Williams, the traffic consultant, will give his presentation on all three of the proposed options. Third, both supervisors and members of the audience will hold their questions until the end of the presentation. Fourth, at the end of the presentation, the supervisors will have an opportunity to pose questions to Chris. Fifth, after that, I may call for a 10-minute break if it seems that we need it. If we take one, it will give you a chance to stand up and examine the boards that are in the back of the room, or use the restrooms, which are off to the front. But with or without the break, the rest of the evening will be devoted to public questions and comments.
She acts like she's doing
this
a big deal.
As I said at the beginning, no decision will be made tonight. The supervisors must have a chance to consider what they learned tonight, and a few more days to hear from not only those present, but anyone who could not be here and wishes to comment. Seventh, following this meeting, each township independently will discuss the options at a subsequent public meeting. For East Whiteland, that discussion will take place during the regular supervisors meeting next Wednesday, June 12th at 7 p.m. East Goshen will decide at a later date. I'm sure they will post that on their website when it's going to be on the agenda. After considering all the information and comments, if both townships come to the same conclusion, that will become the final decision. However, if the two boards are not in agreement, they will schedule another joint public meeting to try to come to consensus. Once a decision is made, it will be announced and work will begin on next steps. the most from this meeting, there are a few rules of the road. First, I anticipate there will be many questions and opinions from the audience. While I encourage everyone to speak their mind, I anticipate that after a while, the questions and comments may become repetitive. Should that occur, I will take the liberty of stepping in and seeking other questions or comments. It's not my intention to be rude, but to make sure that we hear all points of view.
Then you listen to all people.
Second, I expect everyone to respect each other and pay attention while someone is speaking. No interruptions, no side conversations, no shouting out. We are all in this together. Third, this is not a forum for lobbying, cheering, clapping, or booing. We are all
this is
here,
bullshit.
Supervisors and residents, to gain a solid foundation of information on which to make a decision. So that said, Janet, is there anything you'd like to say before we proceed?
I think you covered everything and
put your mic on, maybe.
I think you covered everything.
No, they don't want you to think.
In order to save time, since I figured we'd be here for a while, why don't we just start?
I'd like to see if one of us, like, or my guys would like to say something.
Oh my God, what a control freak she is. She acts like she cares. Mary, that's the chair of the supervisors for East Whiteland. Sue Drummond.
Obviously, 352 and King Road has been a problematic intersection for some time. And I am approaching this meeting with an open mind as I listen to the residents, the homeowners, engineers at command, and representatives from PennDOT. Again, thank you for taking the time to come out and see us.
Very briefly to thank everyone for coming. It is very good to see many people here. That way, everyone will get the same information at the same time and be educated in the same way. The best way to avoid rumors is to have all.
She's horrible. Not a decision to make at all.
Very serious decision, and it will be considered very serious. Frankly, personally, I'm uncomfortable even having that power and authority. So we will examine all the factors, and this is to everyone as much and as long as it takes.
Thank you. All right.
John there? Our manager?
Okay. Oh, I got it.
Forgot what he looked like. You have to watch the comments. They're picked up on camera.
All right, we'll get started. Welcome and thank you all for joining us this evening for this joint township meeting to present and discuss information related to potential improvements for the intersection of Route 352 and King Road. And thank you to Immaculate University for hosting us tonight. Also with me tonight is Jamie Coach from McMahon Associates and Jeff Gaiman from McMahon Associates. So what are we hoping to accomplish this evening? So, well, first off, we will summarize current conditions at the intersection, which all of you understand as well as anyone if you drive through this intersection often. Secondly, we will present possible improvement options. We will discuss next steps, and we look forward to receiving your feedback. There's a lot of information to go through, so please allow us to make the presentation, and then we'll take questions. So the intersection is, as shown on the slide, is signified by the star. It's located on the south side of Route 30. Route 30 runs across the top of the slide. The intersection is surrounded by several key roads. It is located midway between the Route 202 30 bypass interchange and the intersection of Route 29 and Route 30. We know that when there are traffic issues on Route 30 or on Route 202, we tend to see an increase in traffic through this intersection, as King Road serves as an alternate parallel route to Route 30. Also, as you know, due to the rail line that runs parallel to Route 30, there are very few north-south connection points to Route 30, and therefore Route 352 is a heavily traveled route between Westchester Pike and Bailey Pike to the south, and Route 30 to the north. So here's a close-in view of the map. The intersection is again signified by the star. Route 352 runs north-south. King Road runs east-west between West Whiteland Township on the west side and the borough of Malvern to the east side. Both King Road and Route 352 are state-owned roads. In terms of traffic volumes, King Road carries between 6,000 and close to 11,000 vehicles per day. Route 352 carries approximately 9,000 vehicles per day. So there's a lot of traffic moving through this intersection. And given the location of this intersection, much of that traffic is pass-through traffic. That is traffic that is moving through the local area from point A to point B. So a little background on what has occurred to date. So the intersection was studied by both East Whiteland and East Goshen back in 2004 and 2005. At that time, the recommendation was to improve the intersection as a signalized intersection and to widen the roads to improve the intersection layout and to add left turn lanes. At that time, this project did not move forward due to a lack of funding. However, it was added to the Chester County Transportation Improvement Inventory, which means it has been recognized by the county as a needed transportation improvement project. So where are we today? So today the climate for transportation improvements has changed somewhat, and there is a somewhat greater opportunity to secure funding. So both townships have decided to revisit this intersection. So our work to evaluate this location was reactivated in 2017 and 2018. To date, all that has been prepared are conceptual improvement plans of possible options. In early 2018, we met with PennDOT to discuss the intersection and possible improvements. Then now speaking for East Whiteland, in April of 2018, about a year ago, the information was first presented at an East Whiteland Township Board of Supervisors meeting. And I believe there have been similar discussions at East Goshen Township as well. So the next steps that were decided upon last spring were to refine the evaluation and to refine the improvement options, which is where we are now in the process and the reason for tonight's meeting. capacity at the intersection, or said differently, there is not enough lanes through the intersection. Specifically, we are missing left turn lanes on eastbound King Road and on both Route 352 approaches. There is only a single left turn lane traveling westbound on King Road. Also, the intersection is skewed and King Road is offset, which creates other challenges. The skewed and offset alignment results in the need for what we call split signal phasing on King Road, whereby both approaches operate separately, which is very inefficient for moving traffic, and I'll talk more about that in a moment. So let's talk more about the offset of King Road. So this creates a situation of interlocking left turns from Route 352, which creates added delay and motorist confusion compared to a typical intersection whereby left turn movements are able to occur in front of one another. So not only is this unsafe, but it is also inefficient as it creates added delay due to motorist confusion. Also, the skewed intersection alignment results in very tight turning radii at the intersection, which is more difficult to maneuver. Also, the offset alignment, the offset intersection, the intersection grades, and specifically the uphill grade on eastbound King Road, and the presence of vegetation within the intersection limits the view of oncoming traffic on King Road through the intersection. Again, these conditions create added delay through the intersection. What does that mean? It just means it takes more time to travel through the intersection. So for all of these intersection layout issues, it is necessary to have what is called split signal phasing. So what does that mean? Well, in this case, it means the King Road approaches operate with their own traffic signal phase. So let's see what that looks like. So today, phase one would be the Route 352 approaches. They receive a green signal phase at the same time. That's concurrent phasing. Phase two would be the exclusive eastbound approach of King Road. And phase three is an exclusive westbound approach to King Road. So split signal phasing, as I said, is extremely inefficient, as more traffic is stopped for longer periods of time while only one leg of the intersection is being served by the green light. By comparison, a traditional 90-degree intersection operates with concurrent phases, where more traffic is moved at the same time under the same green signal indication through the intersection. So we have a video here at the intersection. Go ahead, Jeff. So this is a video which shows a little bit about how the intersection operates today. This was taken during the morning rush hour period, and the line that you're seeing at the bottom, this is the northbound Route 352 approach. And we can see that there's delay created by the lack of left turn lanes. And since the left turn traffic, there's delay created when a left turn vehicle sort of wants to make its maneuver, is unable to do so, like that van is doing, and it holds up the through traffic behind it. Also, there's added delay and confusion by motorists due to the offset intersection.
Yeah, where is it?
And the interlocking left turns, whereby traffic is not sure whether they should turn in front of or past the oncoming traffic. We also gathered available crash data for the intersection. Between 2013 and 2018, there were a total of 32 crashes. Most were rear end and angle crashes, which is not a surprise for a signalized intersection, especially one with this awkward layout. Fortunately, most of the crashes involved property damage only. The intersection experiences on average 5 crashes per year, and for our purposes as traffic engineers, this is typically a threshold level when we look as to whether improvements are appropriate to improve the safety of the intersection. So the next step is to evaluate the operations of the intersection. So how do we do this? So we as traffic engineers, we measure the delay of the intersection, and we look at the queuing of vehicles through the intersection. We focus on the peak hours, which in this case is the weekday morning and the weekday afternoon commuter rush hours. The measurement of delay, which we call level of service, is kind of like a report except in this case, the level of service A through D is passive and represents acceptable or tolerable levels of delay. Level of service A through D is anywhere from 0 to 55 seconds of delay. A level of service E is an intersection experiencing between 55 and 80 seconds of delay, and this occurs when an intersection is approaching capacity. And finally, a level of service F is when an intersection is experiencing more than 80 seconds of delay. And it's at this point the operations of the intersection exceed the available capacity and improvements would be needed. We also look at queuing, which is the stacking of vehicles during the weekday peak rush hours. So how does the intersection operate today? Well, today, the intersection operates with an average delay of 84 seconds, which is a level of service F. So since I said earlier on, A through D is considered acceptable, E and F is unacceptable. This is a level of service F intersection, so it's indicated by the red circle. So on average, it's 84 seconds of delay during the peak hour. The delay can vary. So for some, the delay may be less than 84 seconds. For other traffic, for other motorists, the delay may be greater than 84 seconds. But on average, 84 seconds is the peak hour delay today. Realizing that the traffic signal operates within an 80-second cycle length today, this means that on average, it's not uncommon to sit through at least one full signal cycle before making it to the intersection. With regard to queues, during the peak hours, most of the time they extend anywhere from 400 to 700 feet on either road. But I can tell you from our observations, there are occasions when the queues extend even longer. So there is an unintended consequence of the delay and the queuing issues that occur at this intersection. Impacting both townships, there are traffic movements which should be occurring at the intersection, as shown by the dashed lines, but what's happening today is motorists are avoiding the intersection and they are cutting through the surrounding neighborhoods. So as traffic engineers, when we evaluate and plan for improvements, we do so based on future traffic conditions. So in this case, we are looking at traffic conditions in the year 2028. So if we were to do nothing and leave the intersection as it is today,
otherwise known as when there's no open space left,
then we'll be in real trouble.
And it will experience an increase in intersection delay, and it will experience an average peak hour delay of 162 seconds, which is about double what it is today, or the equivalent of sitting through two traffic signal cycles. Also, the queues will increase to about 700 to 1,000 feet, compared to 400 to 700 feet today. So what have we learned so far in the process? So while today we have an intersection with layout and geometric issues, this creates traffic flow problems in the form of delay and lengthy queuing. As a result, there is a neighborhood cut-through traffic due to motorists avoiding the intersection. And no surprise, in the future, if we were to do nothing, there will be worse traffic flow, longer delays, and longer queues. So the conclusion from my perspective only is that improvements are needed to address the intersection. So during this process, we looked at several improvement options. There are two options that focus mostly on changes to traffic signal operations and phasing. And there are two options that involve road widening and physical changes to the intersection. So option 1A involves signal phasing changes only, whereby similar to the King Road split phasing that exists today, we looked at what happens if we split phase the entire intersection, whereby every approach gets its own phase. Well, what would that look like? So phase 1, in this case, would be southbound Route 352, phase 2, northbound Route 352, phase 3, eastbound King Road, and phase 4, westbound King Road. So it's taking what is a three-phase signal and a four-phase signal. So how does this option perform? So first off, remember that doing nothing in the future results in a level of also results in a double service.
Of course it does.
And the intersection delay is increased. It would be 370 seconds of delay, which is worse than if we were to do absolutely nothing.
You know, I really don't care.
It is also the equivalent of waiting through about 4.5 traffic signal cycles. Also, with separate phases, the queues get longer.
When I get up to speak, I'm going to get up.
By comparison, as shown in the orange circles, by the queue lengths in the future, if you were to do nothing. So the queues would be worse
no,
in the future than if you were to
no,
do nothing. So why is it getting worse under this improvement option? Well, with separate signal phases, there is a lot of lost waiting time. Since as one approach gets the green light, everyone else has to wait. Again, split phasing is necessary in certain locations when dictated by the intersection layout, as is the case today with King Road, but it is the least efficient signal phasing for traffic operations. So the next option is really a variation. Option 1B also involves signal phasing changes. As we know, the King Road approaches have the split phasing today. But with this option, we looked at what happens if we put the split phasing onto the Route 352 approaches only and not on King Road. So what would that look like? So phase one would be southbound Route 352 by itself. Phase two is northbound Route 352 alone. Phase three would be King Road left turn movements only. But to do this, it would require construction of a left turn lane. So to have separate left turn phases, we need a lane from which to perform this movement. And there is no left turn lane on eastbound King Road. So this scenario would require widening for a left turn lane on eastbound King Road. And then phase four would be through and right turn movements on King Road. So where we are unable to run the left turn movements with the through movements because of the layout issues and the obstructed views through the intersection. A left turn vehicle needs a clear line of sight to oncoming traffic in order to be able to make that maneuver with through traffic. That doesn't exist here, so left turns have to operate separately. So how does this option perform? So first off, remember that doing nothing results in a level of service F with 162 seconds of delay. If we were to introduce all separate phases, as in the prior option 1A, it results
does everyone notice that
F
so far any of the common sense solutions are all
B,
F?
The intersection still operates at a level of service F, but the delay gets slightly better, 220 seconds of delay. So option 1B is better than option 1A, but it is still worse than if we were to do nothing. From a delay standpoint, it would be better to do nothing than to implement option 1B. So with 220 seconds of delay with option 1B, that would be the equivalent of waiting 3 signal cycles. Also, with switching the split phases, the queues get longer. By comparison, as shown with the orange circles are the queue lengths in the future if we were to do nothing. So the queues on 3 and 4 legs are worse than if we were to do nothing. So again, why is this? Well, there is more traffic during the peak hours, there is more traffic on Route 352. By adding separate split signal phasing on 352, there is added lost waiting time by having those separate phases, and that's what results in these conditions. So the next two improvement options involve road widening and physical changes to the intersection. So option two consists of maintaining the traffic signal control, but widening the intersection to improve the layout and to add left turn lanes. In yellow, and I know this is difficult.
Everything except the circle, which they say they're not going to do, is a failing option.
In red hatch, which again is very difficult to see here, is the area of additional land that would be needed to accommodate this road widening. So let me explain what that means. So there is a PennDOT right-of-way on both Route 352 and on King Road. That is the area that includes the road, and it includes the area alongside the road. The additional land would have to come this improvement. In my role as a traffic engineer, we would generally define these additional land areas that are needed in this option as sliver acquisitions, since they do not require the full impact to any one entire property. But it is an impact nonetheless, and we are not at all trying to have that point. So today, there is only one left turn lane, and that is on westbound King Road. With this improvement, there will be three additional left turn lanes, so we end up with a left turn lane on all lanes of the intersection. Also, I need to point out that on the southwest corner, right here, on the southwest corner is the three-ton tavern, which has its historic significance, and under environmental regulations, we are required to minimize impacts to this property. Also, I want to mention that if there is a need, or if there is a decision to move forward with any option that requires obtaining land or right-of-way for any improvement, there is a PennDOT process that has to be followed, which involves property appraisals and payment of fair market value.
Eminent domain.
So we know that under current conditions, the intersection layout requires the need for the inefficient split signal phase. Well, with this improvement, we can eliminate the offset and the interlocking left turns on Route 352. We can also eliminate the need for the split signal phase and for the King Road approaches. So what would the phasing look like? Phase one would be an exclusive left turn phase for traffic turning from Route 352 on King Road. Phase two